Hey everyone, Adam with Droid Media here, and today we're making our very own DIY motorized time-lapse sliders. Time-lapses can be a great way to showcase the passage of time in your project, and we can give that footage a little bit more of a cinematic element by adding in some movement. Now, we do this by hyperlapses, where we move the camera a little bit in those intervals, or we can do it on a smaller scale with a motorized time-lapse slider, where our camera will move very slowly over that amount of time. And we're going to make our very own today for under $250. Now, the main components of this project are this IGIS rail with a sled, a small or scrap piece of 16-gauge sheet metal, a small 1 RPM DC motor, a dimmer control knob to control the motor's direction and speed, a small plastic box to house the motor controller in, some female wire connectors, a couple pulleys, a length of timing belt, a small battery to power the whole thing, some miscellaneous nuts, bolts, and other hardware, and a small tripod head. Now, I will have a list of all of this stuff in the description below. Like I said, at the time of recording, all of this stuff came in at under $250. It was like $248, $249. Now, a quick note. Originally, I had bought the IGIS slider like a 3-foot length about 9 or 10 years ago, and I decided that I didn't like how big and bulky it was, so I cut it down to just under 2 feet to make it more portable, but still allow me about 18 inches of usable motion. Regardless of what size you go with, just be sure to get enough pulley belt to go double the length of your slider. And with all that being said, let's jump right in. Step one, measure out a 3x6 inch rectangle and a 3x2.5 inch rectangle on your sheet metal and cut those out with a hacksaw. Then you'll want to grind the sharp edges down with a Dremel or a file. The smaller piece will be used to attach the motor to the slider, and the larger piece will be used to hold the battery and motor controller box. We want to drill a hole in the small piece, so lay your slider on top, line it up, make a mark, and then drill a 1/4 inch hole. This piece will actually sit on top, so we need to cut a few notches so it will sit flush within the slider channel. Make a couple marks where the slider channel is, and then line up your holes and mark how far in the piece will sit. Then cut those notches out, and you should have a small piece that will sit nicely within the slider that we can mount the motor to. Set that aside for right now, though, and get the larger piece we cut. We're going to mount this piece under the slider using the same hole as the motor mount, so mark and drill a hole in the corner of this one. Now you should have both pieces ready to mount. Go ahead and test it out with a 1/4 inch bolt and a nut. Now I'm using a lock washer at the bottom to keep some additional tension here. Tighten everything up and make sure it fits and that the motor still has enough room to be mounted before we go any further. We want to drill a 1/4 inch hole for the motor shaft in the middle of this small piece. So use a ruler or a tape measure to find the center, make a mark, and then take that piece off and drill the hole. Now we need to drill some holes to mount the motor. The easiest way to do this is to grab a scrap piece of paper, put it over the motor, and then use a pencil to rub the corners until you find the holes, and then use the pencil to poke a little hole in the paper right there. We'll use this as a sort of template when we're drilling. Then drill those holes, and we don't need these very big. I think I used an 1/8 inch bit here. Check to make sure everything lines up, and then attach the motor with 4 small bolts. I just took my motor into the local hardware store and found some that fit. I believe that they were M3 sized. Once that's mounted, go ahead and bolt everything back onto the slider, and then use a smaller Allen wrench to attach one pulley to the motor shaft. For the pulley on the other side, use a small bolt and a nylon bearing and attach it that way. The nylon bearing should sit flush on the slider and allow the bolt and pulley to move freely. Set all of that aside for now and grab your plastic box, motor control switch, and female cables. Prep your motor controller by removing the directional switch module, the main knob, and the nut. This box fits everything, but it is a tight fit, so we want the knob to come out the end, not the side. Make a mark in the middle of one end and drill a 1/4 inch hole. Feed the bare knob through the hole from the inside, and then use the nut to secure it, and then attach the knob to make sure it all fits. Then we can take this off, and we want to make a hole for the directional switch. I wanted mine on the outside so it wasn't tight against the motor. I drilled a couple of small holes next to each other, and then filed it into a rectangle. Just be sure to measure and see how large you need to make it. Then we want the power in and out from the opposite side as the main knob. So drill two holes there. I think I used a 3/8 inch bit. And then grab your power cables and using a little hot glue, attach them to your box. And don't burn yourself. Hot glue is hot. I used a little hot glue on the outside as well, just for some added durability. Then cut your cables down so you have about 3 or 4 inches to work with. Peel them apart a little and strip about 1/4 inch off the ends. This switch should go on now because it actually needs to go over one of the wires. Carefully wind it through and then snap it into place. Now we can attach everything to the main control board. Attach the directional switch module back into the board. The power in and out are marked, just loosen the screws, feed the bare wires into the correct spot, and tighten back down. Now carefully put the board into the box, feeding the knob through the main hole. Secure it with the nut and attach the knob. This is going to be a tight fit, but everything should snuggle nice and close inside of it. Once you've got everything in, go ahead and attach the top of the box with the screws. Then take your power cord and cut off one end. Strip the ends and then solder them to the correct connections on the bottom of your motor. Now remove your sled from the slider and we want to attach the pulley belt to this so the motor pulls it back and forth across the slider. So use some super glue and attach the flat side of the belt to the flat side of the rail block under the sled. Then we want to attach this turnbuckle to the sled as well. This will allow us to tighten or loosen the belt as needed. Now we'll do this by drilling a 1/4 inch hole off to one side so we don't interfere with our tripod head. And we want to make sure that it's on this side that the belt is coming out of. Then grab another 1/4 inch bolt, your nylon spacer, then thread the bolt up through one of the eye loops in the turnbuckle, then the nylon spacer, then the sled, and then use a nylock nut or a lock washer with a nut to attach it. Then attach your tripod head. And you can actually attach this even before you do anything with the turnbuckle. Then slide the sled back onto the slider and attach the pulley, wind the belt around both pulleys, and measure out approximately where you need to attach it to the turnbuckle. Make a mark, and then take the pulley back out and the sled back off of the slider. Then using some wire, we're going to attach this belt to the turnbuckle. I went around multiple times and I tightened it frequently with some pliers to make sure that this was really secure. Cut the excess wire and pulley belt off. Now it's back under the slider with the sled. Attach the pulley, wind the belt back around both pulleys, tighten using the turnbuckle if needed, and then grab your battery and your motor control box and we are ready to go. Now I scratched a couple arrows on my box so I would know what cord goes where. Then attach everything and double check that it works. Make sure that it goes both directions. And that the knob gives you a variable speed. Once you're all set, stick some Velcro onto the battery box platform and the bottom of the battery box so it can sit securely while in use. So there you have it. You should have a DIY motorized time-lapse slider just like this one. Now, if you've actually followed along with this tutorial and you've made one of these things, I would love to see it, and I'd really love to see the kind of content you're creating with it. Leave links to any of that stuff in the comments section below. Now, if you've got any comments or questions about this video, or you run into problems during the build, leave those in the comments section below too. I'd love to hear from you, or I'd love to help out. I really appreciate you taking the time to watch this long tutorial. If you want more content like this, please click like and subscribe also below. Thank you, and I will see you in the next video. Man, I just don't belong on YouTube.